はい。
So today I have the pleasure to have here to present this seminar, Professor Boris Malomed. He is visiting us, sponsored by CAPS in the print program of the graduate course. So Boris arrived here 3 days ago. He stayed here up to October 29. And well, this is the second time that he comes to the department. He was here about 5 years ago. And during this period of 5 years, that time, he presented some seminars based on this research on solitons. And he interacted with the research. He gave, at that time, he gave a good contribution for the Albert Rainer thesis. He was working with solitons and Boris helped a lot on that. And this time he is came here to present this, not only this talk, but a course next week. And we are planning to interact in research. I wrote here some words to read about his scientific life. Boris Malomed was born in Bielorussia. He received a PhD in physics from the Moscow Physical Technical Institute and the Doctor of Science, that's the habilitation there, from the Institute for Theoretical Physics of the Ukrainian Academy of Science. He worked in Moscow at the Institute of Oceanography of the Russian Academy of Science. And in 1991, he moved to Israel, to Tel Aviv, where he's a professor there. His research interest includes nonlinear optics, matter waves, bosine condensation, solitons, and nonlinear waves in general. He published more than 1,000 original papers, two or three books. I could not check if it's two or three.
No, it's actually two.
Two, okay. About 20 review articles. His H index is 72, according to
73.
That's according to the Web of Science, but according to the Google is 87. He has more than 40,000 citations, and well, he served as in the editorial board of several journals. Recently, he was in the divisional associate editor of Physical Letters, and presently he is editor of Physical Letter A. Yeah. So Boris maintains a very active research with many people, many collaborators, and that's impressive because he had collaboration in China, Japan, USA, Italy, Spain, Portugal, France, England, Russia, Serbia, Romania, Mexico, Chile, Israel, and Brazil. So he traveled to all these countries quite frequently, and I think that he works 24 hours per day. Because every time that we send him a message, he answered immediately. So it seems that he is always on. So in Brazil, Boris has research collaboration, had a research collaboration with us at Recife, and with the people that many of you knows. For example, he had papers published with Sadan Alikari and with Lauro Tomil. They were former members of this department. They work at UNESP, Instituto de Física Teórica. He has papers published with Arnaldo Gamal, who is the Physics Institute of USP. Paper with Vanderlei Bagnato, which is in USP São Carlos. And with Wesley Cardoso in Goiás.
Goiânia, yes.
Goiânia, yeah. So today he will speak on multidimensional solitons, inops, and bosons, matter wave, I suppose. And well, so it's a pleasure to have you here. I liked very much when you accept our invitation to come again, and I hope that you come other times.
Okay. Can you realize soon? So it's my.
Yeah. You need some help?
Okay. Yeah. I will go. It's my pleasure to have a second chance to visit this university. And I would like to ask, to thank Professor Cid Araújo for his invitation to come here. So it's my second, as Professor Araújo mentioned, my second visit to Recife, and actually my fifth visit to Brazil. And as to serve this particular talk, and Professor Araújo also mentioned next week I'm supposed to give sort of a mini course for students. So the same, this material will be also a part of that mini course, but in that case it will be presented in more detail and at a level which I hope will be more understandable to students. Maybe today for students it will not be very easy to follow the presentation. One small thing which is not related to the topic. There are booklets of some online, a relatively new online journal, which is called Symmetry, where I happen to be a member of the editorial board, so people who are interested can pick up the booklets from here. Okay. So let's proceed to the particular material. So the concept of soliton is probably well known to most people in this room. So, it actually becomes relevant in many media which support wave propagation when there is competition of two different factors. One factor is a classical dispersion or diffraction, which tends to stretch any wave packet. And on the other hand, if the medium is nonlinear, it may give rise to self-focusing effect, nonlinear self-interaction of waves, which try to compress the wave packet. And in many cases, one can reach a stable equilibrium between these opposite trends to self-spreading and self-compression. And as a result of this, it's possible to predict theoretically and create experimentally a localized wave packet with a permanent shape. So this is a solitary wave, or what is briefly and commonly called a soliton. So the concept of solitons was introduced in 1965 in the classical work by Zabuski and Kraskal. It was essentially a numerical work, where they simulated numerically found remarkable properties of solitons in a particular equation, which is a Korteweg de Vries equation. And as concerns applications to optics and Bose-Einstein condensates, arguably the most important model is a different equation, which is written here, probably also is very well familiar here. It's essentially the Molyneux-Schrödinger equation. So that it's written here in the one-dimensional form, and so if this term is ignored, everyone of course will recognize after rescaling the one-dimensional Schrödinger equation for the quantum particle in the free space. And the equation is made nonlinear if this additional cubic term is added, which implies self-attraction of different parts of the wave function. So the origin of the name nonlinear Schrödinger equation is not simply because it's an obvious nonlinear generalization of the Schrödinger equation. As a matter of fact, the equation was introduced by Schrödinger himself. Because Schrödinger, after he discovered his famous equation, he won the Nobel Prize and all that, he thought that maybe the most fundamental equation in quantum mechanics should be nonlinear. And therefore, it was sort of his speculative extension of quantum mechanics when he tried to replace his famous linear Schrödinger equation by a nonlinear equation of this type. And this attempt failed because it was easy to check that this formal equation, which is introduced by Schrödinger, predicted experimental facts which were not observed in real physics. So this equation was abandoned, and much later it actually was given new life in a completely different context, not as a fundamental equation of quantum theory, but as an effective equation, which is very important in many areas, chiefly of classical physics. Then it's a simple exercise to see that this equation admits this elementary solution. This is a famous soliton, a localized solution. It has, as you commonly know, has two free parameters. One is eta, which determines simultaneously the amplitude and the inverse width, and also the frequency shift of this solution. And on the other hand, the second free parameter is simply the velocity. Now, in 1973, when already this nonlinear Schrödinger equation and the existence of solitons were known facts, there appeared a famous theoretical work by Hasegawa and Tappert, and they actually can analyze the propagation of light in a nonlinear optical fiber. The nonlinearity was induced by the classical Kerr effect, that is the effect that when light propagates in the dielectric material, it effective if the intensity of light is not very, very low, it effectively feels not the, in addition to the classical refractive index, it also feels an effective correction, small effective correction to the refractive index, which is induced by the self-interruption of light, as a matter of fact. So, in this work, it was they started from the Maxwell's equations, applied all sorts of relevant simplifications, and eventually they derived exactly the nonlinear Schrödinger equation, one-dimensional equation for the propagation of light and fiber, and then they immediately made a prediction that because the soliton solution was known, they predicted that solitons made distant optical fibers, and then 7 years later, they were indeed created experimentally, and that's also very famous experimental work by Molinaro, Stoll, and Gordon. So this is a famous picture borrowed from their paper. So what happens if the power of the input pulse is not too is relatively low, then this pulse simply spreads out in the linear regime. But when the power becomes sufficiently high, there is they observe self-trapping of this stable pulse of light, which was a soliton. Moreover, it was predicted that the same the nonlinear Schrödinger equation may have also not only this elementary fundamental soliton solutions, but also higher order exact analytical solutions. It's roughly speaking the fundamental soliton times any integer number. So it generates exact solution in the form of two solitons, three solitons, and so on. These are breezers. These are objects which are not do not keep a stationary shape, but they periodically oscillate. And so in this first work, they actually were able to observe not only fundamental solitons, but also this pulsating breather states, as a matter of fact. Okay, then the idea in terms of fiber optics, the idea was that this stable soliton may carry one bit of data, and an obvious possibility would be to use solitons as carriers of data in a new generation of fiber optic telecommunication networks. Huge amount of efforts and money was invested into this exploration of this possibility. Systems were built, and it was demonstrated with full confidence that indeed solitons can be used as data carriers. However, as concerns the commercial implementation of this soliton-based telecommunication links, the only commercial link, as far as I know, was built in the year 2003 in Australia. The length of that link is approximately 3,000 kilometers. It serves two cities, Adelaide and Perth. And then big telecom companies, providers of this service, they lost interest in solitons because the interest switched to other essentially linear techniques such as wavelength division multiplexing, and because it became clear that very high bit rates can be achieved without switching to the nonlinear regime, still using the linear mode of propagation, and therefore this huge activity did not find, as far as I know, any extension in terms of the commercial telecommunication networks, except for building the single link. Actually, the particular company which this single commercially sold system was built in England by the company which is called Solstice. And then after selling the single system, the company went bankrupt, and the provider of telecom services in Australia, which installed this link, also went bankrupt, but this link already existed. It was bought by the big Australian provider of telecommunication services, Telstra, and as far as I know, Telstra is now using this soliton-based link from time to time as a backup for another link that they already had, which connected the same pair of cities. Okay. And then, proceeding to more academic to academic aspects of the studies of solitons, exactly the same equation was derived in a completely different physical setting, namely in the studies of propagation of matter waves in the Bose-Einstein condensate, the quantum gas of bosons, which may be loaded into effectively one-dimensional, the so-called cigar-shaped guide for matter waves. And as a result, this equation, in the case when it applies to Bose-Einstein condensates, is usually called the Gross-Pytaniowski equation, but essentially it's the same as the nonlinear Schrödinger equation. Therefore, it's also going to produce solitons in the effectively one-dimensional situation. And so this relatively simple idea was experimentally implemented simultaneously in two independent works. Both were published in 2002. One was published by the group of Randy Hewlett from the Rice University of Houston, and another by the group of Salomon from Paris. So they use the same atomic species, lithium-7. Then similar solitons were created in another species, rubidium-85, and eventually in some other species as well. And so this is a famous picture taken from the experimental paper by the group of Hewlett. So what they were able to do, under more or less controllable conditions, they were able to create not only a single matter wave soliton, but clusters of solitons. So in particular, this famous image shows a cluster of more or less 7 solitons with different amplitudes, which was created in the experiment, and this is a directly taken photo of the cluster.
Question?
Yes.
In this case, is there propagation of the wave packet along a certain direction?
Well, it may, this particular solenoid may, in the experiment, sometimes it may be standing, it may be also moving. It depends on the initial conditions.
Okay.
So this cluster, I guess, was, it was, even if it was moving, was, the speed was very small. So it was essentially it's a standing pattern. Okay, now, after it was well established that one-dimensional solitons in various physical settings described by effectively by the nonlinear Schrödinger equation may be created and were created experimentally, a natural question is that this equation can be easily made under physically relevant conditions two or three-dimensional, not only one-dimensional. And then the question is if one can predict the existence of multidimensional solitons and eventually if one can discover them in the experiments. So on this topic of multidimensional solitons in optics, they are also called spatial-temporal solitons because in the fibers, there's a temporal solitons. Similar solitons are well known in the spatial domain. Spatial solitons, when they are multidimensional objects, they are simultaneously self-trapped in the propagation direction, like in fibers, and in the transverse direction, like in planar or bulk waveguides. Therefore, they are called spatial-temporal solitons. So there was an early review on this topic, which still reports some relevant material. And then, as concerns other reviews, there was an intermediate review, which I published some time ago. Some particular aspects of this topic were considered there. Then, this year, we published a sort of a more systematic review. This journal, Nature Reviews Physics, so with co-authors who are based essentially in the city of Barcelona. This Luis Turner and Yaroslav Patashov. Luis Turner is probably, his name is very well known. He is the director of the Institute ICFO in Barcelona. Yaroslav Patashov is a Russian researcher who splits time between this institute and Institute for Spectroscopy of the Russian Academy of Sciences in Moscow. And Gregory Astraharchik, he is another Russian scientist who is now a professor at the Polytechnic University of Catalonia in Barcelona. Okay, and then one particular topic which plays an essential role in this, in studies of multidimensional solitons, these are solitons with embedded vorticity, vertical solitons, so there is a still more recent review, especially focused on studies of the vertical solitons in two and three dimensions. Okay, now there is a principal difference between studies of solitons in one dimension and multi-dimension. The difference is the stability. Normally speaking, solitons in one dimension tend to are stable objects. Sometimes they may be unstable, but it's actually, if they're unstable, it's more or less a pathological situation. So normally they are stable. In two and three dimensional situation is completely different. There are very serious reasons for these solitons to be unstable. And therefore, the most essential issue in the theoretical and experimental studies of multidimensional solitons is their stabilization. Therefore, in an attempt to overview this topic, it's quite natural to classify the results according to the possibilities to stabilize the multidimensional soliton. So then the structure of the remaining part of the talk actually I probably will not have enough time to consider everything in detail, but in principle, so first I will briefly recapitulate the well-known results concerning the traditional models of solitons in the two-dimensional space with a cubic nonlinearity, nonlinear Schrödinger equation, which are always unstable, and this is a big problem that they're unstable. Then relatively old material, so the possibility to stabilize them maybe to use of optical materials where the nonlinearity will be not cubic but even quintic, so that the additional quintic nonlinearity may itself defocus, and it can arrest the main mechanism of the instability. This is a collapse, a spontaneous catastrophic self compression of the optical field. So if the quintic self defocusing is added, it can arrest the collapse, and this way it can make multidimensional soliton stable. The fundamental soliton is stable in this case, theoretically, is quite obvious. It's, of course, non-trivial to demonstrate this experimentally. What is completely non-trivial, both theoretically and experimentally, is to answer the question if this type of nonlinearity may stabilize solitons with embedded vorticity.
Excuse me. Yeah. Since you mentioned one-dimensional system,
yes.
Perhaps solitons in the form of spins in a magnetic system.
Well, also there are, of course, magnetic solitons too, yes, but they are usually described by different equations.
Yes, so but they have any interest in those
high peaks? Yes, there are, so, one of the models which applies to magnetic systems is a Sine-Gordon equation. The Sine-Gordon equation easily gives rise exactly to kinks. So these are solitons, roughly speaking, in the form of I mean, you can say in some sense, in the form of a domain wall, in some sense. Yeah, but this is a different story, magnetic solitons. Because there is a general equation for the evolution of magnetic, of the magnetization field, it's called Landau-Lipschitz equation. It's actually, this is a rather complex equation. In one dimension, it gives rise to exact soliton solutions. In the multidimensional case, the model is quite complicated. Okay, then next topic will be it's a more recent development. It was just as far exists only as a theoretical form. It was a prediction of the fact that with exactly the same cubic self-focus and nothing else, rather unexpectedly, it was possible to predict that two and three-dimensional solitons can be stabilized in a two-component Bose-Einstein condensate by means of an additional purely linear effect, which is called spin orbit coupling. And then, depending on time, I will try to briefly mention the newest addition to this topic, and actually quite exciting because it was done not only theoretically but also experimentally. This is a prediction and experimental demonstration of the fully three-dimensional solitons in the form of the so-called quantum droplets. They exist and are stable due to the action of the additional effect, quantum fluctuations around the mean field for the classical states. Okay, so let's proceed to the stuff. So this is a two-dimensional nonlinear Schrödinger equation. Mathematically speaking, one can look at it in the polar coordinates in the plane of xy. Then one can look for solutions in this form. So mu in application to BC is usually called mechanical potential. In optics, minus mu is a propagation constant, essentially. Then it's say there is angular variable, S may be integer, it's a vorticity. So if S is equal to zero, this is a fundamental soliton with zero vorticity. And if S takes any integer value, it will be a vortex soliton. And then there remains the real function capital U, radial for which one can derive the ordinary differential equation, which can be easily solved numerically. So as a result of all this, one can, first of all, numerically obtain as a family of such isotropic solitons with zero vorticity. They are quite famous objects under the name of Town solitons, because historically speaking, this was the first example of solitons which was ever considered in optics. Actually, it was considered, the paper was published 1 year before word soliton was coined, therefore they were not called solitons, they were called self-trapped optical beams. And they are called Town solitons because one of the causes of the paper is very famous optical beams Towns. For some reason, although there are three authors of the paper, but these solitons are called traditionally Town solitons. Okay, so these are quite nice solutions, isotropic. The only problem is that they are completely unphysical. Unphysical for the reason that they are completely unstable, and there is no chance to create them experimentally. And why is they unstable? Because exactly the same equation, two-dimensional nonlinear Schrödinger equation with cubic self-focusing, gives rise to a completely different dynamical effect, which is called collapse. Collapse means a catastrophic self-compression of the wave field, so that after finite evolution time, or in terms of optics, finite propagation distance, the wave field will form in the framework of this equation a true singularity. So originally, this is a radial cross-section of the soliton, this is direct simulation, originally it seems to be stable, but then suddenly it begins a process of a catastrophic self-compression, eventually the singularity will be produced in the framework of this mathematical model. So what happens is that, okay, okay, what happens is that the collapse happens when the norm of the input, norm in terms of optics is the total power, or in terms of BEC, it's the total number of atoms essentially up to the scaling factor. If the norm exceeds a threshold value, finite critical value, the collapse starts to develop. If the threshold falls below the critical value, then the dynamics is different, the input simply decays. And so the soliton, it's actually what's called the separatrix. It's a specific solution which is exactly a border between two different types of dynamical behavior, either self-explosion collapse or simply decay. So as any separatrix solution by itself, of course, is unstable, because if you add a small perturbation, you will push it either in the direction of the collapse or in the direction of of spreading, but by itself, the solution, of course, is unstable. Therefore, Town solitons are, as it looks, beautiful but unphysical solutions. And then it's possible to, as I mentioned already, to construct more general solitons of the Town's type by embedding vorticity. So for the first time, it was theoretically predicted by a group of people from Minsk in Belarus. And this is a radial cross-section structure of this soliton with embedded vorticity. It has a hole in the center. It's the same hole as you can see in the classical asymptotic form of the Bessel function, essentially. Okay, and then what happens actually, as I mentioned, the Town solitons with zero vorticity are unstable against the collapse. All these vortex solitons, they are still more unstable. They are destroyed not by the collapse, but much faster. They are destroyed by the splitting instability. So for example, if we construct the soliton with vorticity 1, spontaneously, the instability starts to split it into two fragments. These fragments are essentially more or less fundamental solitons. Later, they will blow up because of the collapse. And then this is a similar simulation when vorticity is equal to 2. Then the fastest growing mode of the instability splits this ring into four fragments. It's essentially more or less four fundamental solitons. Each one is going to blow up eventually. Okay.
How is this related to angular momentum? Means with angular momentum?
The angular momentum is conserved, of course, because first you have the intrinsic momentum, you can call it spin momentum. And then, of course, this each object by itself has no intrinsic angular momentum, but they separate so that they have orbital angular momentum.
Don't you have the case of three? You have two and four, it's not three.
Three, it depends. I don't remember all details. Maybe at some parameter region. Well, okay, these modes which you can see here are the most probable scenarios for the development of the instability, because they correspond to the highest instability growth rate. But sometimes there are additional unstable modes. Sometimes I guess some of them may split it into three fragments. Okay, so as I mentioned already, these Town solitons, they are separatrices between two different types of dynamical behavior. And what's noteworthy, this is of course not a single solution, this is a family, because the chemical potential mu may take any negative value, and one will always have the soliton. Now, what is the essential fact, which can be very easily proven in the course of 3 minutes, is that the entire family is degenerate in terms of its norm. All the solitons have exactly the same norm, which does not depend on the chemical potential in terms of optics or the propagation constant. So this constant value of norm by itself cannot be found analytically, but the fact that it's a single value can be very easily proven. Analytically, it can be approximately calculated by means of what is called the variational approximation. So this crude analytical approximation is 2 pi, not terribly different from the numerically found actual value. And as the same is true for Town solitons with embedded vorticity, each class of Town solitons, which each value of the vorticity has its constant value of the norm. okay, so this already mentioned actually. Yeah, so now if we hope to stabilize the solitons, the most essential approach may be as follows. if we can apply some additional physical effect which will lift this degeneracy of the norm, then different two-dimensional solitons will be able to accept different values of the norm, and maybe if one is lucky enough, these values of the norm will be pushed below the critical value which is necessary for the onset of the collapse. This means that if it's possible to lift the degeneracy in this way, the solitons will become secured against the onset of the collapse. Collapse simply will be impossible. The norm is not sufficient for it. In that case, the soliton will have nothing to do but to become stable. So essentially, we will say that indeed this simple idea can be realized in some physically relevant situations. On the other hand, if we want to stabilize three-dimensional solitons, the situation is still more challenging, because in three dimensions, solitons are also killed by the collapse. However, it's a supercritical collapse. A supercritical, this simply means that the critical value necessary of the norm, necessary for the onset of the collapse, is equal to zero. So that we have no chance to stabilize the solitons in three dimensions by pushing its norm below the collapse, the critical value, simply because the critical value is zero. There are some possibilities to stabilize three-dimensional solitons, but the situation is more challenging. Okay, now, finally, how solitons can be stabilized. So, the first possibility, which was studied in detail in various contexts, this is the change of the nonlinearity. So, this is the nonlinear surgical equation written immediately in the three-dimensional form for generality, so to say. This is the usual cubic self-focusing, and we assume that additionally we can add, after rescaling, some. It was opposite sign, the quintic self-defocusing term. Then the mathematical problem can be formulated in a straightforward way. One can use cylindrical coordinates, try to look for solutions in this form. Again, generally speaking, with embedded vorticity. If it is equal to zero, it will be a fundamental soliton. Okay, and then originally people believed that, it's obvious that this model will stabilize a fundamental soliton with zero vorticity, because the quintic nonlinearity will not allow it to blow up through the collapse, and then the fundamental soliton should definitely be stable. What was quite non-trivial is the issue about stability or instability of the vertical solitons. So originally people believed that vertex solitons always remain unstable. Nevertheless, empirically, it was found in this paper by two people in Spain, Quiroga Tejero and Michinel, that in two dimensions, this relatively simple cubic quintic model unexpectedly gives rise to a whole class of stable vortex solitons. And then this was investigated also essentially by means of numerical method, but in a more mathematically rigorous framework by mathematicians from the US, Pego and Marshall, and they justified, so to say, more rigorously that original empiric finding by Quiroga Tejero and Michinel. And then, then the question is that if it's known that the cubic quintic nonlinearity may stay in two dimensions, may stabilize solitons, if this can be demonstrated experimentally, so for fundamental solitons with zero vorticity, it was done systematically, directly for the first time, as far as I know, in this paper. So partly it was done at this university by Professor De Araujo and by Edilson. And as far as I know, thus far there was no experimental demonstration of the stability of the soliton with embedded vorticity. In this work, solitons were demonstrated to be stable, but with zero vorticity. Okay, and then the question is, if we jump to the three-dimensional case with the same cubic quintic nonlinearity, again, since the fundamental soliton will be stable, it's obvious without any analysis. And quite a non-trivial issue is one can stabilize the three-dimensional solitons with embedded vorticity, so it was analyzed by means of numerical methods relatively long ago in this paper with many authors. And the result is that with vorticity 1, it's possible to identify a subfamily of stable three-dimensional vortex solitons. So the family of solitons will be characterized. So this is, in optics, it's called the energy, the three-dimensional norm of the soliton. Or in BEC, it will be essentially up to the rescaling, the number of atoms. And so the family of solitons is usually characterized by the dependence between the wave number in terms of optics, so minus chemical potential in terms of AC, and this energy norm, if you want. So, first of all, for the fundamental solid, which is S equal to zero, this entire branch is stable, and the second, bottom branch is unstable. It's very easy to understand why, because there is a fundamental, not sufficient, but necessary stability criterion, which was derived by people whose names, Vahidov and Kolokolov, back in the Soviet Union in 1973. And the Vahidov-Kolokolov criterion, which is now quite famous, is a necessary but generally not sufficient condition for the stability of any family of solitons. It is with or without vorticity, it doesn't matter, with any dimension. The only condition is that they must be created by the self-focusing nonlinearity. And then the necessary stability condition is, in this dependence of the norm or energy versus the wave number, the local slope must be positive. In that case, the solitone has a chance to be stable. If it is negative, it will be unstable. Exactly according to this criterion, the bottom branch is unstable because it has a negative sign, but the entire top branch is stable. The situation is much more complex for the vortex solitone with vorticity 1. In that case, indeed, it's important that the Vahidov-Kolokolov criterion is not sufficient. So it says that this entire branch, in principle, may have a chance to be stable. However, this criterion completely ignores the possibility of the splitting instability. Roughly speaking, it only takes care of the instability against collapse. But it knows nothing what to do about the splitting instability. And eventually, the result is, for this subfamily of solitons with vorticity 1, this part is indeed stable, fully stable, and this part is also, according to Vahidov-Kolokolov, maybe unstable, but it's unstable against splitting. So here, the solitons are stable against splitting. For vorticity 2 and higher orders of vorticities, according to these results, solitons remain completely unstable. And now this is some illustration. So this is a three-dimensional situation. A soliton is a form of this donut, it has a hole because of the vorticity. It was originally deliberately strongly perturbed, relatively strongly perturbed, and it quickly restored its unperturbed shape. If its simulation was deliberately run with parameters for which it was predicted that it must be stable. On the other hand, one can take, for example, the soliton of this type with vorticity 2, when it's known that it must be unstable. This time, no perturbation was added. Just the perturbation, the source of perturbation was small errors of the numerical scheme, truncation errors of the numerical scheme. In this particular case, actually, someone asks a question, by the way. This donut spontaneously splits into a set of three fragments. Each of them is a fundamental soliton, essentially, which by itself is, as a matter of fact, trivially stable.
Mm-hmm. In the first case, in the previous case, it was demonstrated experimentally.
Is it three dimension? No. The three dimensions, there was absolutely no experiment, as far as I know. In three dimensions, hopefully I will have a couple of minutes at the end to mention. There is experimental demonstration of the so-called quantum droplets, but the model is different. It's a little bit similar. This model is cubic quintic. The model which was realized experimentally is cubic quartic, not quintic. Maybe I will have a couple of minutes to mention it. Okay. okay, now, so these are relatively old results, some more recent results in the use of the spin orbit coupling. So as far as was overly predicted, theoretically, we did some work with my collaborator in Japan, Hidetsugi Sakaguchi. Ben Lee was his PhD student at the time, and also Evgeny Sherman is a professor at the University of the Basque Country in Bilbao, Spain. In modern studies of Bose-Einstein condensates, one of a very popular direction is the use of ultra-cold bosonic gases to emulate very well, classical effects from solid-state physics. Emulation means one can try to create a setting in terms of the ultra-cold gases, which of course physically completely different, but it is described by effectively the same Hamiltonian as some classical effect from condensed matter physics. In particular, this approach became very popular for the emulation of the spin orbit coupling, which by itself is a classical effect of physics of semiconductors. It means that when the electron is moving through the electrostatic field of the ionic lattice, due to the slightly relativistic, quickly relativistic Lorentz transformation from the laboratory reference frame to the reference frame of the electron, this electrostatic field creates a weak magnetic field in the moving reference frame, and then the intrinsic magnetic moment of the electron couples to this effective weak magnetic field created by the motion of the electron. This is essentially a spin orbit coupling. Then it was demonstrated that in completely different physics, this essentially the same Hamiltonian can be implemented in a binary two-component gas. In that case, what happens? The spinner wave function of electrons with components which correspond to spin up and spin down is artificially mapped into a two-component bosonic wave functions of atoms in this condensate. So that one component is formally identified with spin up, another with spin down, although in reality these atoms have no spin. Okay, so this idea was implemented theoretically, experimentally, and considered in a number of theoretical works. Okay, and then by itself, the spin orbit coupling is a purely linear effect. But because, as I already mentioned, the condensates have intrinsic nonlinearity, it was a natural idea to try to see what will happen as a result of the interplay of this relatively new linear effect. Spin orbit coupling was a traditional intrinsic cubic nonlinearity. In particular, what will happen if this intrinsic nonlinearity is self-attractive, self-focusing? So that the first expectation would be that still collapse will happen because it seemed intuitively obvious that the addition of the linear effect will have nothing to do with the suppression of the nonlinear collapse. In reality, the situation is different. So this is the model. These terms describe the presence of the trapping potential. It's simply this is necessary in any real experiment, but for the theoretical analysis, these terms can be ignored. We can consider the simply free space without any external potential. This is a system of two-dimensional Gross-Pitayevsky equations, nonlinear Schrödinger equations, if you want. So this is the usual cubic terms, self-attraction and cross-attraction, because we have two components. They can also attract each other. Now the new terms, the spin orbit coupling, it was derived in previous works, is described by these groups of linear terms. So what happens? The spin orbit coupling effectively, this is represented by linear terms which mix two different components. So this is equation for phi plus, and these terms are expressed in terms of phi minus, but it's not direct mixing. Direct mixing, it would be what is called the Rabi coupling. And this is the mixing in terms of the first spatial derivatives. It's a specific feature of this implementation of the spin orbit coupling. Okay, and then
how do they produce the voltage, the potential?
Potential is used actually in the real experiment because otherwise atoms will escape. But as concerns the prediction, theoretical analysis, it's possible to predict stable solitons in the free space. So one, roughly speaking, one can create a soliton and then switch off this trapping potential and the soliton should survive. Okay, so then one possibility is that if one will analyze these equations, and it's very easy to see that it admits this exact, answer. So that means that one can have an exact general structure of the solution in which one component will have zero vorticity, it's fundamental. Then automatically, the second component, linearly coupled to the first one by the spin orbit coupling terms, will automatically have vorticity 1. This pair 0, 1 is actually of vorticities. Is a characteristic feature of the spin orbit coupling. And then it's possible, then it remains to find this remaining functions numerically. So this is a typical example, is a cross one-dimensional cross section of the two-dimensional soliton. So this red curve is the absolute value of the wave function in the zero vorticity component, and this dashed line is the absolute value of the wave function in the second component which carries vorticity 1. For this reason, it also demonstrates the presence of the hole as usual, drilled by the vorticity. And this is a zero vorticity component, therefore it has no hole but has a maximum. And so this soliton, two-dimensional soliton, we call it semi-vortex because vorticity is present in one component. It is stable, and moreover, the most simple but most essential result is this one. is dependence, the family of solitons represented by the relation between the chemical potential and the norm. So I already showed something similar. In that case, it was shown in terms of optics. Instead of mu, it was minus the propagation constant. But essentially, it's the same type of the presentation. Now, what happens here? There are some simple but essential facts. First of all, it satisfies the Vahita-Kolmogorov criterion. Previously, the criterion had the opposite sign. The slope had to be positive, but now it's negative for a trivial reason. Mu, by definition, is minus k, which was shown previously. Now, what is quite essential? When mu falls to minus infinity, the total norm will attain a finite limit value. This is nothing else but exactly the well-known norm of the Town soliton. What it means? If the chemical potential becomes extremely large and negative, these two components soliton degenerates into a single component one, so that the vortex component becomes empty. All atoms are concentrated in the fundamental component, and this is exactly the Town soliton. However, at any finite value of mu, we have these states in which both components are present, and what is quite essential, the norm is smaller than the critical value necessary for the onset of the collapse. And this is a possibility which I mentioned. If we can create stationary soliton whose norm is smaller than the critical value necessary for the onset of the collapse, they, as a matter of fact, have nothing to do but to be stable. Indeed, they are completely stable in the numerical analysis. And then it seems that it's not a rigorously proven statement, but a very plausible assumption. When we have the traditional nonlinear Schrödinger equation in two dimensions with self-attraction, this is a system which does not have the ground state. Or formally speaking, the ground state is a collapsing one, because when it's collapsing, its energy is falling to minus infinity. Now, these newly formed solitons created by means of the spin orbit coupling, these actually are previously missing ground states of these two component system of coupled nonlinear Schrödinger equations. And, okay, this is already I said. And now the question is, can it be somehow extended to three dimensions? As I mentioned, the three dimensional situation is still more challenging because we cannot use the same philosophy. As we cannot try to create solitons whose norm would be smaller than the collapse threshold, because the collapse threshold in three dimensions is equal to zero. And the eventual answer is that absolutely stable solitons, this is a model. This is again a system of two coupled, in the matrix form, two coupled three-dimensional nonlinear Schrödinger equations with a cubic self-attraction, a cross-attraction here. And sigma is a vector of three Pauli matrices. Nabla is the usual, the gradient. So this is a spin orbit coupling. This particular three-dimensional spin orbit coupling is called wild type of the coupling. Okay. And so what happens here is that, unlike the two-dimensional case, absolutely stable solitons cannot be created because the three-dimensional collapse, being supercritical, cannot be suppressed. Nevertheless, after some analysis, maybe I will skip it, it's possible to expect that, by means of some crude approximation, although we cannot create absolutely stable solitons, but maybe it's possible to create a soliton which correspond to some shallow minimum in the dependence between the total energy and the size of the soliton. So the soliton, if you strongly compress it, collapse will occur. However, if you will create it somewhere here and apply only small perturbations, it will be a metastable state. And finally, in the numerical form, it was possible to create it. So these are typical examples of stable three-dimensional soliton in this model, stable against small perturbations. So there are different types of them. This is the most straightforward solution. It's semi-vortex. This is a component with zero vorticity. And this here, there is, it's not very well visible, but there is a pivot or axis of the vorticity here. This is the vortex component. Then this is another type of the three-dimensional soliton with this fancy shape. It's called the mixed mode. Mixed mode because at other values of parameters, what is completely stable is against small perturbations. This is a state in which the vorticity is not distributed as 0 and 1 between two components, but each component mixes terms with vorticity 0 and plus or minus 1. It's also possible. And so in this case, These are three-dimensional stable solitons of this type, which also can be created in this model. And now, maybe I have several minutes to mention this.
Question, please. What is, you, question. You mentioned that the speed of coupling is provided by the Rashbaum-Dresserhaus.
Yes, yes. This
is via natural gas.
Yes.
The question is, what is the excitation that undergoes a boson condensation?
Excitations?
Yeah. Is it two-dimensional electron gas?
Yes, it's two component. Well, it's a two-component condensate in which the Rashbaum. Actually, what I mentioned was essentially the Rashbaum Hamiltonian. The Rashbaum Hamiltonian is artificially emulated by means of specifically chosen form of laser illumination of this two binary boson condensate.
Has this been observed experimentally?
It was observed, but it was observed all thus far. Almost all the works were essentially all the experiments were one-dimensional. There are very few two or three experimental works which reported the observation of spin orbit coupling in a two-dimensional situation. In 3D, as far as I know, nothing was observed. However, thus far, all the experiments were run with a single atomic species, rubidium 87. And the peculiarity is that rubidium 87, the nonlinearity is always repulsive. It can be made attractive, but in other atomic species, like lithium 7 or rubidium 85. For some reason, it's not seem to be a principal reason, just for technical convenience. People did not try to produce these results in those atomic species which admit self-attraction. Mm-hmm. Okay, so if I have a few minutes, let me mention this newest addition to all this topic. This is the use of the so-called Li Huang-Yang effect. So Li and Yang, these are very famous people who won the Nobel Prize for the prediction of the parity non-conservation of weak interactions. And among many other important works which they did was this one. They considered essentially the mean field theory which gives rise to the Gross-Kondratiewski equation essentially, and they considered effective correction to this mean field theory which can be produced by the fact that there are quantum fluctuations around this semi-classical mean field approximation. Okay, then this well-known result was much more recently applied to the spatially inhomogeneous Bose-Einstein condensates in the theoretical work by the Russian physicist whose name is Dmitry Petrov. There was a Russian physicist, Dmitry Petrov, who worked here and moved to Barcelona. Unfortunately, he died. This is a different person with the same name, Dmitry Petrov. He's younger. He works in Paris. And then there was this additional work by Petrov and Astrakhanov, which Astrakhanov was already mentioned today. What Petrov proposed is the following possibility. Take two-component, again, binary condensate. Assume the situation when in each component we have self-repulsive interaction, which is most natural for the atomic collisions, because when atoms collide, they usually bounce back, which means a repulsion. It may be switched into attraction by means when the external magnetic field is applied to the gas, it's a so-called flashback resonance. So the natural interaction is repulsive, but sometimes it can be effectively switched into attraction. And consider, first of all, that you have two components. In each component, you have self-repulsion. However, you can also assume that by means of this flashback resonance, the interaction between different components can be made attractive. Then consider, for simplicity, the case when wave functions of two components are simply identically equal to each other. Then you will have it still a single Gross-Kondratiewski equation instead of two. And then you can assume the situation when this cross-attraction is slightly stronger than intrinsic self-repulsion. Therefore, you will obtain a single equation still with the attraction. By itself, it will give rise to unstable solitons and collapse. However, the result of Li Huang and Yang means in each equation where we have self-repulsion, we have a correction to it. Correction is produced by the quantum fluctuations, and eventually is described by this quartic term, not quintic, but quartic, with positive gamma, which means it's self-repulsion in any case. It seems a bit strange because it's a non-analytical term. What means a non-analytical? Analytical would be when we have power 2 or power 4, cubic quintic. Here, for some specific reasons,
It's not analytical, the power is quartic. The power is neither 2 nor 4, but 3. Nevertheless, this is the result. And then, if you look at this equation, it's immediately obvious that it, this higher order nonlinear term will, of course, prevent the collapse. It should be possible to create a fundamental soliton. Its stability, theoretically speaking, is obvious. What is still not obvious, if a vortex soliton can be created. Then, in the paper of Petrov and Astraharchuk, they analyzed what happens if the this condensate is strongly confined from 3 dimensions to 2 dimensions, then the eventual result is different. The nonlinearity is simply cubic, but with this effective additional logarithmic factor. Again, what happens here, for small density, the logarithmic factor is negative, it means self-attraction. Now for large density, the logarithmic factor becomes positive, and we have this effective switch of self-attraction into self-repulsion, and this is a possibility to stabilize the soliton.
Right. Mm-hmm. So, in this what term, that means the region is non-symmetric?
Formally speaking, yes, but this is not, you know, this is not a condensed matter, this is simply gas.
Okay. In any case, would the term on second order not be higher and do the same effect?
Excuse me, once again?
So instead of having the psi 3 and then psi and psi second order term,
yes,
not quark, would it not be stronger and give the same effect or not?
Mathematically speaking, formally, this is the next order term which can be added to this, formally speaking. And the result is simply that it turns out to be, it really exists, and turns out to be self-repulsive.
So if you take terms of chi 2 and chi 3,
yeah, yes,
it would be chi 4. So why not chi 2 and chi 3 instead of chi 4?
Okay, you mean absolute value of psi times psi, simply chi 2. Right. Simply, there is no reason for its existence in the case of Bose-Einstein condensates. It's not a material medium way of propagation of light. It's a rarefied gas. There is no reason to have what would be chi 2 in terms of optics. And this would be, actually, this term would be called, in terms of optics, formally speaking, it would be called chi 4.
Yeah.
Well, here, this one exists due to the quantum fluctuations around the mean field. This is the theoretical result, actually classical result of Li Huang and Yang. Okay, so what happens in this case? It was this idea was very rapid, very quickly implemented experimentally by two groups at least.
What? Mm-hmm. Yeah, I had to go out. So when I arrived, Anderson made one question,
yes,
his own question, that has to do with this chi 3 and chi 5.
I guess the question of Anderson was that we have, formally speaking, this is like chi 4.
Okay, so if you try to propagate the soliton in one material without inversion symmetry.
Yeah, but this language is not very appropriate because there is no material here. It's simply rarefied gas.
Okay, but you can make this analogy for the soliton.
Well, you can make analogy, and the result is there is no source to have term chi 2.
No
reason to have it. Actually, it appears, but in a different situation. If you will further reduce the dimension from 2 to 1, so you can so it was as a result of Astraharchuk and Petrov, you can eventually assume that the condensate is very strongly compressed in 2 transverse directions and is free only in 1 direction. In that case, they have chi 2.
So take a material like a lithium niobate, that you have a chi 2, strong chi 2, and then you propagate the beam there,
yes,
and you have contribution of chi 3. Always.
Yes, of course.
So you have these two terms present.
Okay. Yeah, okay. Here the situation is in 3 dimensions. Maybe something formally similar, but the main term is chi 3 and the additional one is chi 4. Why chi 4? Okay, this is the property of Bose-Einstein condensates with quantum corrections. Because it's not exactly the same as in optics. But chi 2 formally does appear, I said. I did not mention this here, but they derive the effective equation when you will eventually have one dimensional equation.
Because I thought in chi 5 as a cascade chi 2.
Yeah, but this is not cascading. It's not cascading because this case 4 is not a result of cascading. They're physically completely different origins. This is a mean field approximation. This is a quantum fluctuation. So completely different effects.
I think those things are related to three particle interaction. No?
It's not a three body collision. Three body collision would be chi 5. It will be quintic, here is ignored. In principle, if I have a couple of minutes, I will mention what is the role of three body collisions. But the role is completely different. Okay, so to answer the question is that if further is to reduce the dimension from 2 to 1, eventual result will be the Li Huang Yang term. In that case, indeed, formally speaking, produces a chi 2 effect. Okay, now this is experiment. The experiment was done with a condensate of potassium atoms. The first experiment was published by the group of Leticia Torrell at the ICFO Institute in Barcelona. And this is essentially what they observed. If the self-attraction, effective self-attraction, was too weak, the input would simply spread out. If it was too strong, it would blow up through collapse. But if they would select appropriate parameters, they could observe an effectively stable soliton. Actually, this soliton was essentially two-dimensional, not three-dimensional, because they strongly, for some reasons, compressed this condensate in one direction by the external potential. And so they call this type of the soliton, they prefer to call it not a soliton, they call it a quantum droplet, because there's some analysis suggests that the stuff inside of the soliton can be considered not as exactly as a quantum gas, but rather as a quantum liquid, but ultra-dilute. The liquid with extremely low density, moreover, they claim this is the most dilute liquid which exists in physics. Because actually its density is like four orders of magnitude smaller than the density of air in this room. So this is the experimental result. Now, what the role of three-body collisions? In reality, this droplet will disappear after the time, which is roughly speaking something like 30 microseconds. And the reason will be exactly the three-body collisions. So the three-body collisions, which I ignored in this theory, what they do, it's known that they play the role of dissipation, because this gas actually has two components. This gas has a condensate, and it has a thermal component. So these three-body collisions, are not what they do, they kick out the atoms from the condensate part into the thermal part, which means that this is effectively a dissipative term, loss. And so this three-body losses eventually will kill the condensate, and definitely after the time exceeding in this experiment 100 microseconds. Okay, then this is another experiment by the same group. Roughly speaking, similar picture. Here everything spreads out, but here they have a formation of a stable, more or less soliton-like object. And then another experiment with the same atomic species was reported by the group of Ingusho from Florence. This is their result. So here again, when the parameters are not appropriate, it spreads out. But when the parameters are appropriate, they form the stable effective soliton. The difference from the experiment in Barcelona is that they, or they say, at least they claim so, are really three-dimensional isotropic objects, because they're not strongly compressed in any direction. Okay, and now a couple of additions to this. The natural question, at least at the theoretical level, is can we predict the existence of vertical solitons in this, using this type of the settings? As far experimentally, no one tried to do it. Theoretically, it's possible to do, first of all, in two dimensions. So the result is indeed, it's easy to predict stable two-dimensional solitons, and embedded vorticity can have as big values as, for example, 5. So this is a ring soliton with a very large intrinsic hole, which is drilled by a very large value of vorticity, this time 5. Nevertheless, it may be stable. Sometimes it's unstable. When it's unstable, as usual, it splits. And then, moreover, what is also can be predicted, we started from the binary condensate,
two-component wave function, right? And we assume the two components are identical. However, we can consider, allow them to be different, and then one can construct a solution in which the amplitude distribution in two components is identical, but the phases have the opposite sign. So if you compare the phases, phase structure of two components, they have exactly opposite vorticities, plus one and one and minus one. So we call it a state with a hidden vorticity, hidden because the total angular momentum is equal to zero. And surprisingly, there is a relatively small parameter region in which such a solenoid with embedded vorticity plus or minus one in the hidden state can be stable as well. And then, okay, this is still the newest addition. It's okay, I don't have time to talk in any detail. It's a situation when one can consider a parallel array of effectively one-dimensional traps for the condensate in this case. And in that case, one of the results is that one can predict the existence of what is all more or less here and here. This is what may be called a semi-discrete vortex. It's continuous in one direction and discrete in the other. Okay, and then eventually, this was all this theoretical analysis was done in 2D in the full three-dimensional model. One can also try to construct three-dimensional vortex solitons. The result is that they may be stable. So this is a case when it's unstable, it splits, this time into the three fragments. However, one can select parameters when they predicted to be stable. Indeed, in the very long simulation, it remains completely stable, and even some solitons can be found to remain stable with embedded vorticity too.
Yes, I have a question.
Yeah.
In that previous one.
Yeah.
If you just try to make it stable, one of these vortex. Mm-hmm. For example, you have it there five, right? Mm-hmm. If you move one, what happens with the other one? There's some kind of interaction
between you want to mean the interaction between two vortices?
Yes.
Well, this is a good question. Thus far, I guess, it was not simulated systematically, even at the level of some examples. So it's a good question, but thus far, no work was done about it.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, now we can come to conclusions. So the conclusions are that in the multidimensional setting, a very important issue for two and three-dimensional solitons, which makes them dramatically different from the one-dimensional case, is the stability of the solitons, because they are prone to strong instability mechanisms, such as critical or supercritical collapse. And there are different possibilities to stabilize the solitons against the collapse, so that the simplest possibility is to use a different nonlinear like ubiquity when collapse is automatically arrested. Then something more subtle but also more challenging is to use for just purely linear addition to the model in the form of the spin-ordered coupling. It was demonstrated that only theoretically for the time being that it can completely stabilize the semi-vortices. So two components, solitons in which one component can is vorticity zero, another vorticity one. And then the latest addition to all this activity is theoretical prediction and experimental creation of the so-called quantum droplets, which is roughly speaking the implementation of the idea with the additional nonlinearity. This time, effectively, it's cubic quartic. The quartic terms is automatically almost self-repulsive, and in the combination with the self-attractive cubic terms, it may have a chance to create stable solitons, both fundamental, which was already demonstrated experimentally, and is predicted theoretically, vortex solitons too. Now, okay, maybe another couple of figures, just some additional results in this general, vast topic, vast theme of multidimensional solitons, is in some particular models it's possible to create such quite exotic stable models which have not one but two independent topological charges. One is as usual the vorticity, and the other one is what is so the vortex soliton in three dimensions. This is essentially the vortex towers we saw it has the shape of a torus, right? Now, you can imagine that you can, in addition to having the vorticity, you can twist the torus. So that this internal twist of the torus will be a second dependent topological charge. So such three-dimensional objects with two independent topological charges, vorticity and intrinsic twist, they have a special name in mathematical physics. They are called Hopfields, by the name of the German mathematician Hopf. He did not predict such states, but he predicted sort of a topology, which is equivalent to what you have in this case. And there was some theoretical work which demonstrated that in some particular three-dimensional model, such exotic Hopfields with two independent topological charges may be stable. In most cases, they are unstable, but there are parameters here at which they are stable. And one more, another exotic model, one can create some sort of a model with a spatially inhomogeneous, spatially modified nonlinearity, so that what can be created in this case is so-called hybrid. What hybrid means? One can create a three-dimensional object in which we can, it's built of the top and bottom parts. Each one is a principal a vortex soneton. However, these two guys have opposite vorticities. So one has vorticity plus one, another minus one. You can put them together, and in this specific model, they can form a true bound state. And moreover, this true bound state has a stability region. So that this state, of course, it does not have a true axial symmetry. Each vortex by itself, of course, is axially symmetric. But when you put together two vorticities with, two solitons with vorticities plus one and minus one, you immediately destroy the axial symmetry, and you can obtain the so-called hybrid, which is shown here. And this, quite surprisingly, there are really parameter regions in which such hybrids may also be stable. So there are very many possibilities to construct various types of three-dimensional objects. And what is a really challenging issue is probably to produce more experimental results in this field. Okay, I guess it's definitely necessary to stop here. Thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, you have questions? You have a question?
Okay. I have a couple of questions. One of them, it is, like, from mathematical point of view, if you look at solitons, the vorticity or topological number you associate to the soliton,
yes,
is something that protects the system against the decay, right?
Sometimes, yes, sometimes.
Mathematically, well, I mean, people are interested because of the stability of, yes, the system. But it seems in this, at least in the optical solitons that I see, even sometimes vorticity is against it. I mean, like,
yes, vorticity makes it more stable. Yes, it's true. Actually, what vorticity does, so in that case, vorticity is more or less the same as conservation of the angular momentum because they are proportional. Mm-hmm. So, as I mentioned, there was a question asked about this. Maybe I can jump back and show this once again. Let me try to do it quickly. Some typical picture of splitting. Nearest of them. Okay, this one, for example. Mm-hmm. So this is a typical result of instability. This was a three-dimensional soliton with vorticity, and it spontaneously splits, in this case, into three fragments. What happens is that the total angular momentum is perfectly conserved. Because here it was the intrinsic momentum. You can call it the spin momentum. Here it's the orbital momentum. Because these three guys, they do not, of course, stand in the frozen position, they are moving. And so each one has its moment, linear momentum, and together they have the angular momentum. Mm-hmm. And so it's easy to check, it's a numerical simulation, and the total integral momentum is exactly conserved. However, it does not guarantee the stability.
Okay, so I guess the mathematically how we define the topological charge, that it's not exactly the vorticity here, right?
Yeah, okay, very formally speaking, you can say that here the vorticity, the topological charge is conserved. How you can do it? I guess it can be done as follows. Here is vorticity is obvious. Okay, mm-hmm. Now here, if you look at this triplet of fragments, each of them has its overall face. So you can look at this triangle, and you can consider what will be the total change of the phase as you make this trip. And I am not completely sure about this simulation, but I believe the result will be that if you will make this trip and you will look at the total change of the phase, it will be exactly 4 pi, which means that it's, formally speaking, this configuration conserves vorticity 2.
More question?
I have one. Because you've told that spin orbit coupling can stabilize the soliton,
mm-hmm.
But are you aware of any effect of on stabilization due to birefringence, for example?
Birefringence, well, as far as I can immediately recollect offhand, birefringence, it will somehow deform the, for example, two or three dimensional solitons. As far as I can recollect it, no one reported this stabilizing effect. No, it's not the same as spin orbit coupling. Spin orbit coupling, in terms of the symmetrical model coupled nonlinear Schrödinger equations, this is a linear mixing between two different wave functions through the first derivatives. By refringence, it's represented by the term which acts inside of each equation. They don't mix them.
Yeah, because you could have a nonlinear interaction within a birefringent medium.
Okay, you mean nonlinear birefringence?
Yeah.
Well, I thought you were talking about linear birefringence. In terms of nonlinear birefringence, well, it's difficult to say. I'm not sure that it was studied in detail. In principle, it may have some stabilizing effect because if you write the respective term as a Hamiltonian, it will be, for example, also cubic, but with the extra first derivative. And then, if you try to, for example, to analyze the possibility of collapse, maybe, it's difficult to say exactly, it will have some chance to arrest the collapse. So my impression is that it will prevent the collapse, but it will not rescue the soliton. Soliton still will be destroyed, but simply the collapse will not happen. It will be destroyed just into some radiation, maybe. But I guess it will not be stabilized. But it's necessary to investigate this in detail.
More questions? Boris, could you comment about these light bullets?
Yeah, light bullets.
Yeah.
What is the question about that?
Well, my question is, would you comment a little bit what's the present stage of this?
Okay, light bullet is simply if you consider any spatial-temporal soliton,
yeah.
According to Silverberg, you can call it light bullet.
That's a kind of 3D.
Right? Yes, it's simply the synonym for the spatial-temporal soliton. It's another name for the same object. But if you call the object light bullet, it doesn't mean that you make it stable. So when Silverberg introduced this concept of light bullets, as a model, he used simply the three-dimensional nonlinear Schrödinger equation. Of course, formally it does have a soliton, but it's absolutely unstable.
Okay.
Of course, there is a supercritical collapse. It's absolutely unstable. And Silverberg understood that this solution is unstable. He just said, okay, let us take this unstable solution to still to illustrate the possibility that you may have a three-dimensional soliton. Let it be unstable.
Yeah, one of your co-authors, Frank Weiss,
yes.
he reported on this.
It was chi2 nonlinearity. Chi2, yes. With chi2 is a different story. In chi2, the collapse, if you have pure chi2, in the three-dimensional case, the collapse does not happen. For chi2, collapse formally sets in the four-dimensional space. For this reason, Frank Weiss was able to create a spatial temporal solution, but actually they were not truly three-dimensional, they were quasi-two-dimensional. And in principle, they seem to be stable. The validity of this result is not completely obvious. The point is that the propagation distance in his experiment was no more than maybe 3 times the characteristic Rayleigh length. So if it was truly stable or it was a transient state, it's not quite obvious.
And then? More questions? Questions? No? Yeah, there's a lot of questions there.
Sorry, my last question. I wanted to understand better this threshold norm that you're considering, that below this, that the system can't collapse.
Mm-hmm.
How do we find it in different dimensions? I mean, this is related to the dimension or other parameters?
Okay, it's related to the combination of two factors, dimension and the degree of the power of the nonlinearity.
Okay.
So the point is like this. If you have the cubic nonlinearity, the critical situation is two-dimensional, and then there is a finite critical norm. In one dimension, the critical nonlinearity is quintic. If you have the self-attractive quintic nonlinearity in one dimension, then you have exact solutions. It's very easy to find exact solutions in the case, and you can exactly find this critical norm, which separates, which is the same norm which all solitons have in this case, and this is again exactly the critical norm. When you exceed it, you have the one-dimensional collapse driven by the quintic nonlinearity.
Mm-hmm.
If you are below it, everything decays.
Okay.
And at least formally, in dimension three, the critical power, which also gives rise to the critical norm and critical collapse, is power which is 10 divided by 3.
Okay, more questions? No? So let's thank the speaker again.